There's heavenly music. I hear it. Good morning. So nice to have you worship with us on this Sunday after such a glorious Easter day, wasn't it? Wonderful. I am here with you today. Little Bowie is going to assist at this service, and very grateful for his contribution. We have some announcements to make before we begin today. There will be a new member class on the 21st of May at 8:30 that we invite anyone who is kind of thinking about membership or would like to just go through the class and see what happens there, and that would be fine too. Our Stonemasons group is going to the Reds. You know, tomorrow is the day. We hope it doesn't snow. So they have a sign up in the cafe. Our needs group is collecting personal hygiene products today through a couple of more weeks, through the 17th. And there are bins out there. And thank you for all the donations. I saw some things going in today. And the next Sunday, in between the first and second service, we will have our annual meeting of the congregation, and I'll give you the budget for your blessing, and the nominating committee will bring their report for new officers. It's always a good thing to be in the house of the Lord on a beautiful Sunday morning, and we are glad you are here, and let us prepare our hearts for worship.
Good morning. It's always kind of fun to see friends and neighbors at church. When we travel, we often watch this service, and you may know there's from 15 to 30 people that watch the service. You kind of feel like you're here. You get to see who's in the choir and who's not, who's in the audience and who's not. You worry about the people that you don't see, but we are called to worship together, and that kind of what reminds us when we watch it from home, and we're here together. Our Lord Jesus has called us together today. Our hymns and prayers unite with Christians everywhere. May our worship bring honor to our Lord and Savior, for in Him we live and move and have our being. Thank you. May we continue with our prayer of confession. When we claim to have no sin, we know that we are only deceiving ourselves and that the truth is not in us. Because you are not faithful and just, O God, we confess our sin before you and ask you to forgive us and cleanse us of all of your unrighteousness. God never fails to hear our humble prayers and is eager to grant the petitions of our hearts. Hear and believe this good news. Through Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. Our scripture this morning is a series of parables. Parables were kind of like lessons that were given to the folks in the land. I want you to imagine yourself as young Hebrew workers in the field this morning, because as Jesus speaks to you, he will be using words that you recognize. If I were to talk to you about something being small, I would say molecule or atom, but he will use the word mustard seed because you will recognize that as the smallest thing that you know about. Additionally, as he talks about someone putting their valuables away in a field, that was very common. The banks weren't trustworthy, so the rich people did put their things in the field. And if you were a young field worker and found some of that, you'll hear about it in one of the parables. Then Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, which a man took and planted in his field. Though it is the smallest of all your seeds, yet when it grows, it is the largest of garden plants and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and perch in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast the woman took and mixed into a large amount of flour until it worked all through the dough. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all he had and bought the field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
That's a hard act to follow. We are starting a new sermon series this morning. You may know that as the Presbyterian Church, we have a book of confessions and we have a book of order. And at the very beginning of the book of order are several pages where we have what we call foundational statements. And one of those is a listing of the great ends of the church. We might say the great ideas or the great purpose or why the church exists. And there's six or seven of them. I will take the first one that we have today, and they will be sprinkled out these next 6 or 7 weeks, along with two special services, one from a missionary and one our youth Sunday. But last Sunday, what a beautiful Easter day. The choir, the bells, the trumpet, the flowers. It was just wonderful. It was like a little taste of heaven. But let's say that you were not here, not anywhere near a church, any church, last week or most weeks for that matter. Even though Easter could very well be the only time you do go to church, except for Christmas Eve maybe. But other than that, you were busy on the weekends. And if you did go to church more often, you were pretty sure they would try and rope you in or ask for money and want you to be part of a group or a committee, and really you already have enough on your plate. But let's also say that your route last Sunday morning took you right by the church, this church. And you slowed down and you looked over and you noticed that the parking lot was packed and how lots of nicely dressed men and women and children were walking in. And you noticed how beautiful it all looked. The flowers were blooming, the trees were budding. You could almost hear the music. Outsiders, what do they see when they look at the church? What do they think about us, about church people? Is their impression favorable or not? Do they wish in their heart of hearts that they too were pulling in the driveway and getting out of their car dressed in their best, and that they would know some of those impressive looking people who were walking in? Well, we wish. But that's the question for today. What do outsiders see when they look at the church? What do they think of us? Maybe they wonder why anybody anymore would take their time on a perfectly good Sunday morning and spend it at church. Why give money to the church? And if, perchance, a friend did invite them to come, why would they? So I am here to warn you. Outsiders are watching us. They want to know if there is any difference between those who do and those who do not go to church, if it matters. Ah, the church, our heritage, I'm afraid it has been a mixed bag. On her best days, the church has changed the course of history for the good. But we must admit that there have been other times when the church, not this church certainly, but the church with the capital C, has done things that bring disgrace to God. There is no way else to say it. For instance, since way back, church leaders have been known on occasion to use the fear of the Lord to keep their flock in check. Promises of a dreadful end if members don't comply. Too often we have made a clear distinction between those who are in and those who are out. The righteous from the unrighteous. Those bound for heaven and those going someplace else. Dum da dum dum. God has been merciful to us, fortunately, and somehow the church has survived in spite of the antics of those who know better. Although I'm sure at one time or another, we have all done things or said things or believed things that made God cringe. Like when we act as if we are the sheep and those outside the church are the goats. Curiously, God has always taken imperfect people and still made his perfect will known and sometimes even done, which is what we are talking about today. The exhibition of the kingdom of heaven to the world. That's a mouthful. The church, in other words, is God's way to reveal himself not only here, surely, although this could be the best place to get a glimpse of God in action. So then, what you do and I do matter. The world is watching us. Outsiders are critiquing us. When one of us stumbles, they notice. When things go badly, they are paying attention. I don't want to scare you. In fact, I want to encourage you, because every now and then, right here, heaven and earth touch. And God's will is accomplished on earth just as it is done perfectly in heaven. Every once in a while, there is a ray of hope and peace and love, of reconciliation and forgiveness, of kindness and compassion, and giving sacrificially above and beyond that not only inspires the rest of us, but makes outsiders say, The church, regardless of what you have experienced, is the body of Christ. That's a term given to us by the Apostle Paul in the very first century. He brilliantly came up with the idea that the members of a congregation were together like a body, all different, all necessary, all connected. The body of Christ, the church together, is slowly, ever so slowly, bringing about a new age called the kingdom of heaven. Not up there, but right here. I see it often around here, don't you? When we get together for worship, yes, but also when we are sharing breakfast, as we did yesterday morning, as the men did this morning, when people stop by to take donations of clothing and food to those in need, when we get together in study groups, when our prayer chain lights up because someone is hurting. Whether we're painting walls or pulling weeds, we are doing it together. God uses folks like us, not because we are better than anybody else, not because we have it all figured out or that we are on one side of the line and not the other, but just because every so often we are willing to pay attention to that still small voice inside of us. And somehow the Lord has been able to convince us to follow him. We have figured out that God is here, and so that's where we want to be too. Jesus taught his disciples his own unique prayer that includes his mission statement, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." The kingdom of heaven breaks in wherever God's will is done here on earth. When we worship and sing and pray, when we are kind and gracious to each other, when we welcome the stranger and take them in, when we share the gospel with those who don't know. Anytime someone scoots over to let somebody else sit beside them, whenever there is the smallest act of kindness, anytime we act as Christ would act, when we are connected, then we become the body of Christ on the move in the world. So then back to the question, can the world see that in us? Or is that the way we act when we're here, at least for an hour? But when we get back out there, we may not be any worse, but maybe no better than anybody else. Back at the office on Monday morning, would anyone guess that you were in the crowd walking into church on Sunday morning? What does the world think of us? Especially when the news is awful. When priests molest little boys. When the minister runs off with a secretary. When there is a church fight over things that don't really matter. Heaven help us. You may know of a church that has split over, well, most anything, the color of the carpet. It can be vicious. And if that's happened to you, then you probably didn't stick around very long either, and who would blame you? To our scripture, then. A crowd has gathered by the Sea of Galilee to hear Jesus. In fact, there are so many people waiting to hear what he has to say that he gets in Peter's boat and has him pull away from the shore. Jesus teaches using parables, which might seem an odd way to communicate to us, since you would think he'd want us to get it. But parables it is, so we have to think and pay attention. Jesus is talking about the kingdom of heaven and compares it to a seed which needs good soil and water and sunlight to grow and eventually produce fruit. Much like faith needs time and attention to take hold in us. He tells them that the kingdom is like yeast added to water to make a loaf of bread. Looking at it, yeast is nothing but little granules until it comes in contact with warm water and then it just disappears. You can't find it. Just try and dissect some bread and try to find the yeast. And as you know, bread is flat and not really very good without it. Jesus also wants us to know how valuable the kingdom of heaven is. It's like treasure when someone finds buried in a field and he gathers up all of his life savings to buy it. Or like a fine pearl that is worth everything you've got. A seed needs time to grow, needs good growing conditions. Yeast is invisible and yet it makes the bread rise. Treasure which is buried is found and worth any price. On the flip side, when we act as if we alone matter And when we fail to connect with other members of the body, then we should not be surprised when our little seed fails to thrive and the yeast doesn't have any lift. And when the treasure remains buried in some field and the pearl sits on a jeweler's shelf. Now, I suppose we might wonder if God could have been better off trying something else. But he chose to work through the church in order to show himself to the world, which is quite amazing, isn't it? So then we will do well to remember what happens here affects what God can do out there. This church sitting on this corner is like yeast raising this whole entire community to look more like the kingdom of heaven. That is no small feat. We spend a lot more of our time here than we do out there, than we do in here, and yet God has got to pack a lot in fast. This little bit of time the Lord uses to impact how we talk during the week, what we talk about, how dependable we are, how honest. God wants to affect how we act and think and believe every day, no matter where we are. Now, you may be thinking, Linda, this is just too hard. And that may be. But I guarantee that God knows that it matters whether we're kind or not, whether we go out of the way for a neighbor or not, because what we do, wherever we are, influences how the world sees Jesus. So, here's how we start, if you're still with me. We start small. We ask God to help us to be faithful in a few things, to help us faithfully come to church, help us to get to know the others who are here, to help us find a place where we can serve in His name. Then you grow by investing more of yourself. You join a small group with other believers. You read your Bible and you pray and you contribute. Out there, your boss trusts you and depends on you and knows you can be counted on. At home, your family is better because there is peace in your household. You speak kindly to each other and help one another out. You come to church together until, after a while, this place becomes more and more the center of your life. You become kingdom-focused, and outsiders notice. So here's the bottom line. God uses normal, everyday folks like us to transform the world. He is sowing seeds up and down Montgomery and Mason roads. He sprinkles yeast to build up the work he is doing. What he has given us is precious, beyond priceless. It is what the world needs and what we have to give. So if you have ever asked yourself, wonder what God is up to? Well, here's the plan. It's to infect the world until there are no insiders and outsiders. There is just one great body of Christ. So don't be surprised when someday, yes, every knee will bow, both in heaven and on earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord of all. So may it be so here and throughout the world that God loves.
Jesus.
let us confess our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. I've had several questions about the memorial service for Janet Gittinger, and those arrangements are still pending. So hopefully we will get a notice out to you as soon as they are finalized. Let us pray. There is nowhere else we would rather be, O Lord, than here in your house on the Sabbath day. We are here because we love you, because we have been so blessed by you, because these people around us are more than friends. They are our brothers and sisters, since we are all connected to you. Our faith has been formed here. We have been inspired to live the Christian life here. We have been drawn together and made into a new creation here. It is not our doing. We know that, Lord. It is only by your power, your intention, that this has all come about. May we always prove loyal to you. May we be faithful no matter what life brings. May our joy be complete because of what we have here in this place together. We owe a debt to the many who have come before us, who blazed the trail, who heard your call and sacrificed to pass this fellowship down to us. Our prayer now is that your light, Holy God, will shine through us and will light the way ahead for us, and that many will be drawn to your good news. We pray that your Holy Spirit will surround us and dwell deeply within us and open us to see new possibilities for ministry, ways to help our neighbors, opportunities to share Jesus. May our worship be pleasing in your sight. May all we do and say and think and feel be worthy of the faith we share. And hear us now as we remember the prayer for all Jesus' people. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
You may not think of this as a very exciting time, because the offering usually isn't, but if you read what it's about your gifts for ministry, and many of you in the congregation have having a lot that God has given for you. We have a choir that sings. We have those of you in the pew who simply smile and say hello to the person next to you. We have greeters. We have people who can cook or can even teach us to cook, which in my case is a real challenge. But anyway, we have a lot of talent. So as we come for our offering, it's what God may have shared with us to give back financially, but there's lots of other ways to share your gifts in this church, and financially doesn't need to be the only one. So please continue to think about what you can do for those who are in the pew next to you or in the house next to you or your friend who needs your gift today and tomorrow. May the ushers come forward. We know that the earth is yours and everything in it. We know that it is you who gives us the ability to produce wealth. And it is with this in mind that we bring to you these gifts of love. We give them cheerfully, not as a tax or as a part of a burden to repay. Rather, we give to your church with joy in our hearts as we share in ministering to the saints.
Thank you.
remember this week to love the Lord your God with all your heart and mind and strength. And to remember to love your neighbor as you would hope that they would love you back. And remember to be thankful to the Lord for all the good that has come your way. And may God bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you this day with favor and grant you peace. Amen.